So in today's course, we'll see these things. We'll see history of Hadoop and then Hadoop ecosystem, Hadoop Animal Planet. Why so many crazy names in Hadoop Animal Planet, Hadoop for Hadoop tools? And then we'll see the definition of Hadoop. What key distinction factors are there in Hadoop? And then various components of Hadoop and then architecture. And then we'll also see how a file is written to Hadoop file system or how a file is read. And we'll see some other important concepts called replication and rack awareness. Okay. So as most of you are new to today's class, let me show this to you, Hadoop ecosystem diagram. Okay. So if you see here, HDFS. HDFS is the file system, okay, on which is for storage. So whatever you store on your Hadoop cluster, it is based on this, okay. It sits on this distributed file system, okay. So once you have your data on your HDFS, you'll write a MapReduce program. You'll write a MapReduce program to, you know, analyze that information, okay. So this MapReduce program is based on some programming language. It need not just be Java. Okay, you can write your MapReduce code on in C++ language or in Ruby or Python. Basically, using any programming language, you can code your MapReduce program. Okay, but this is only for you know, programmers, as you can see. So companies like Facebook and Yahoo wanted to develop some high level abstractions on top of MapReduce. That is the reason why they have come with tools called as Pig and Hive. Okay, Hive gives you SQL queries interface. So in this interface, in this tool, you can write your query, which will be converted to a MapReduce program by Hive tool. Okay, so it will leverage Hadoop. That's how it is leveraging Hadoop. Similarly, your Pig is converting your Pig script. Once you write your Pig script, you know, it will be converted to MapReduce program and will leverage Hadoop framework again. So that is the idea of moving to Pig and Hive. One big advantage of moving to this high level languages is, you know, it drastically reduces my program development time, right? So if you have some 2000 lines of MapReduce code, it will be around 100 lines of Pig script. You can just imagine how much of code is reduced here. Okay, so slowly the world is moving towards, you know, Pig and Hive, the high level tools, rather than coding on MapReduce. Okay, so did I answer your question? Hello. I don't remember who asked me that question, but I hope I have answered your question, like what is the relevance of Java and how important it is, right? So Java is not the only thing in Hadoop. Okay, why people say, you know, Java is the prerequisite for this course is, you know, MapReduce is predominantly coded in Java. Okay, this MapReduce is just a programming model. Okay, people predominantly code using Java. That's one reason. So I would say this. Okay, now I'll call MapReduce as MR. So here, in any course, you will see MR concept, and then you will try to see the MR code. Okay, and then you will see the equivalent of it in Pig and also in Hive. Okay, so the only difference for the people who cannot understand Java is you will see MR concept, you will also see MR code, which probably you cannot understand, and then you will see Pig implementation of it, and you will see Hive implementation of it. So it is no harm even if you don't know Java. Okay, you would not understand this MR code, okay, which is actually the heart of this concept. But you know, you know the concept and you know what function you have in your fig or hive, that answer that using that you can go ahead in development. Okay, so in yesterday's session, what we have seen, the summary of yesterday's session is big data is, you know, big data means nothing but it's lots and lots of data in the order of terabytes and petabytes. Okay, so I'm just summarizing yesterday's class, just because so many people in today's class are new guys. Okay, data means, the term it means lots and lots of data. Okay, big data is characterized by three V's. Okay, those three V's are volume, variety and velocity. Okay, so let me show that to you. So when you have data in the order of terabytes to zettabytes, you call that data as big data. Okay, that falls under big data. Okay, when it comes to variety, your data can sometimes be structured data and your data sometimes can be unstructured data. Okay, so data of any form, be it structured or unstructured, falls under the bucket of big data. The third V is velocity. Your data might come in batches. Okay, batch data in the sense, you know, data from some point in your past to some other point in your past. Okay, that is called as batch data. Okay, so velocity, so data which is coming either in batches or streaming data which is continuously coming into your application. So any kind of these two varieties of data is also considered to be fall under the purview of big data. Okay, so if someone asks you what are the characteristics of big data is characterized by three V's, that is volume, variety and velocity. Volume in the sense data in the order of terabytes to zettabytes, and then variety when it comes to structured or unstructured. Velocity, be it batch data or streaming data, all these kinds of data are called as or will fall under the purview of big data. Okay, and guys, there are two kinds of data, right? Structured data and unstructured data. So I just want to listen from you guys. You can type on the chat window. Okay, you have to tell me Word document, this a Word document falls under which category of data? Is it structured data or unstructured data? Can you quickly reply in the chat window? Guys, can you respond, everyone, on the chat window, please? Word document. Thanks, Ambath. That's the right answer. Others, I'm waiting for your response. Yes, Shyam, you're right. Others, please respond on the chat window. Sagar, Pawan, Anjan. Yeah, most of you are right. It is unstructured, right? Because your document might simply have one paragraph of data content. My Word document, I can limit it to just one. And I might also put some object, like some picture or whatever. So there is no hard and fast rule saying that only this kind of data should go into your Word document, right? So my Word document will fall under unstructured PDF data. Okay. Now can you tell me what about PDF and text files? Are they
all these all unstructured? So the structured email is also unstructured. Okay. The XML files and the data generated by the systems would be structured.
Right. Let's come to that one by one. Thanks for answering though. Okay. Yes. So what about email body? The same explanation goes to email body as well, right? So email body also comes under unstructured data. I hope all of you agree with that explanation. So if you have any doubts, you can just stop me. Okay. Let's move to fourth one. Let's keep it third one for later and let's move to fourth one. Data generated by ERP, CRMs, etc. So some systems and data generated by ERP. So what do you think? It is structured data or unstructured data? Kyam has responded. Any others on chat window? Please respond. The fourth one. Data generated by ERP, CRMs. Yes, please respond. I'm waiting for your response. Structured or unstructured? Just a guess will do. Thanks, Sampath. You're right. Others also please respond. Right. So most people are right. It is structured data. Right. So now comes the tricky part of this. What do you think XML files will fall under? Structured data or unstructured data? Anjan, can you answer this question? Anjan? Sagar? Sam has already given his response to me. Anjan, are you there? Can you hear me, Anjan?
Yeah. Tell me, what is your question?
Yeah. What do you think XML file belongs to? Is it a kind of structured language or unstructured language? Just a guess will do.
Yeah.
Yes, Anjan. Yeah. You're right. Have you attended yesterday's demo, Anjan, by any chance?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm sorry. So you already knew the answer. So whatever, Pawan, can you listen to me? Can you answer this question? What category of data that this XML file belongs to? Pawan, are you there? Yes, Anjan. Yeah. So XML file seems to be structured data because it has some tags. Data in XML is basically stored in the form of tags. Whenever you have a start tag, it should also have an end tag, right? So it seems to be structured data. But if you see one thing. No, there is no hard and fast limit of how many tags should be there or how many sub tags should be there inside each tag, or also you know, what would be your tag name? It could be anything, right? So XML files would not even fall under structured or unstructured. Okay, it's a separate class of data, which is nothing but semi-structured data. Okay, because we cannot classify it as either structured or unstructured, so we have just classifying it to, we're just putting it in semi-structured data. Okay, we have seen various use cases and scenarios of big data, like Google, Amazon, LinkedIn. Every big company has started. Big data and Hadoop is popular basically for few reasons. Like in the initial days, all big companies like Google, you know, Facebook, LinkedIn embraced it. Yahoo, essentially Yahoo also. That is the reason why it was so popular. And these days, you know, every company is trying to, you know, have a try at it, because it is so popular. It made, what made it so popular was, you know, this is something new which I haven't discussed in yesterday's class. Okay. Anyhow, we'll see this in today's class in my history of Hadoop. Hadoop has, you know, the record for sorting 1 terabyte of data in shortest time. Okay, in lowest possible time. So in just less than 1 minute, Hadoop has sorted 1 terabyte of data. Okay, and second thing, why Hadoop is so popular is, this is an open source framework. Okay, so you have been listening to two terms interchangeably. One thing, you sometimes you listen to big data and sometimes you listen to Hadoop. So what is big data and what is Hadoop? We have seen the characteristics of big data and we have seen what big data is, the definition of it, right? And we are listening to Hadoop as framework. So the distinction between big data and Hadoop is, big data is a concept. Okay, big data is a concept and Hadoop is a framework to analyze big data. That is the distinction factor. Okay, now I hope you got the difference between big data and Hadoop. Okay, so Hadoop is an open source framework to analyze big data. Okay, so this is all about yesterday's, okay, let's discuss this one more topic. Yesterday we also seen challenges of big data. Okay, so the first challenge being, you know, the slow disk reads and writes. So infrastructure has developed so much, you know, the time it takes to read or write some content from or into a disk still remains very slow. Okay, say we have 1 petabyte of data with us. Now if you want to analyze it, okay, the first challenge that comes to our mind is, our disk reads and writes are very slow. Do we can store 1 petabyte of data in some storage using some mechanism? You know, I cannot read it fast. So there is no point in going for analyzing it, right? If it is very slow, that is my first challenge. I need to address it. The second one is, how do we store a 100 GB file in a machine that, okay, I have a 100 GB file and I have to store it in a single machine. Okay. Now this single machine cannot hold 100 GB of data. So how can I go ahead? Can someone quickly suggest me? I need to save 100 GB of data in a machine, but this machine is incapable of it, of doing it. So how can I go ahead? What approach can I follow? Can I take help of another machine? Hello, can you hear me? Hello guys.
Yeah.
Yeah. So when you have 100 GB of data which cannot be stored in a single machine, what you will do is obviously you will take help of another machine. So you will basically split this data and you will store it in two different machines, right? So, but when you follow this approach, there are two implicit problems. The first thing is, when client wants to read your file back, the file has to be integrated and then it has to be transferred across. And when you have multiple systems for your data storage, your system, your group of systems is prone to failure. You have to handle, you have to make sure that each and every system is up and running. Okay, so that is another challenge of big data. So if we can address these three challenges, right, we can leverage big data for our analysis. Okay, we can move towards analyzing big data. We can say that we can, yes, we can do that. Okay, so Hadoop is the framework which answers all these three challenges. Okay, Hadoop framework provides answers to all these challenges. Okay, so let's move on to Hadoop, history of Hadoop. Okay, so back in 2002 and 2003, there were two guys, Doug Cutting and Mike Caprella. These guys have started working on Nuts. So they wanted to develop some web crawling application which is similar to Google. Okay, so they want to develop some web-based search algorithm, search application. Okay, so they have named it Nudge and they have started working on it. Initially it was going fine, and then, you know, when the data has hit web scales, that is huge amounts of data, you know, their application started to face problems. There were bottlenecks all around. Okay, at around 2003 and 2004, Google has released two white papers. Okay, those white papers talk about two important concepts. One concept is Google file system. Okay, the other concept is, you know, MapReduce. Okay, so this Google file system is talks about how they store, how Google internally stores data in their servers. It is a kind of distributed file system. We have just seen, right? So if you can't save data in a single machine, you'll go and put it in multiple machines, right? So you know, this is nothing but distributed system. Okay, what is distributed system? Distributed system is nothing but a logically a single unit. Okay, I would rather say it this way: physically multiple units acting as a single unit. Nothing but a distributed system. Okay, so Google file system is one distributed file system. Okay, they save, Google save the data with which they have in there using a concept called Google file system. Okay, and also they process this data which is residing on this Google file system using a programming model called as MapReduce. Okay, it follows divide and conquer philosophy. Okay, it is not just sequential program. If you have a task, it will be divided into you know, individual units, multiple individual units, and they process your data. Okay, so after looking at these two concepts, you know, these guys have thought, okay, let's adopt these concepts because, you know, this looks to be great, this looks to fit our requirements, and then they have adopted these concepts, MapReduce and you know, distributed file system concepts, to their application Nudge. Okay, they started working on it, and then in 2006 Yahoo hires Cutting, this Doug Cutting, and you know, they thought of you know, naming it as an entirely different framework because, you know, it has entirely changed the overall design and implementation of Nudge has entirely changed, and they wanted to name it differently, and that's how Hadoop has spinned out of Nudge. Okay, and then in 2007 New York Times converts 4 terabytes of image archives over 100 EC2s, so they have moved their stories to Hadoop. Okay, New York Times in 2007. In 2008, Facebook launches Hive, SQL support for Hadoop. So Hive has been so popular from then. Okay, so because every guy, every non-programmer could also leverage this Hadoop concepts. So Facebook in 2008 launched this very, very wonderful tool called Hive. And then Yahoo has sorted 1 terabyte of data in 3.5 minutes, in under 4 minutes in 2008. Okay, so, you know, it has turned the heads. So many people started looking towards Hadoop because of its capability of, you know, sorting 1 terabyte of data. So 1 terabyte of data means around, let me tell you, according to some estimate, there will be around 1,000 crores of records. Okay, 1,000 crores of records are just sorted in 4 minutes, under 4 minutes, and that's the power of Hadoop. Okay, so as you have flavors in Unix, okay, flavors of Unix are Linux, Ubuntu, Macintosh, right? So similarly, Hadoop has various flavors. One such flavor or distribution, we call it distribution here, is Cloudera. Okay, so Cloudera is a distribution of Hadoop. It formed as an organization which gives Hadoop distributions for us. Okay, and then in 2009, fastest out of a terabyte. So this record has been improved, and then, you know, 1 terabyte of data was sorted in just 62 seconds. Okay, over 1460 nodes, and even 1 petabyte of data was sorted in around 16 hours. Okay, so Hadoop Summit was formed just to, because it is an open source framework and relatively new, people wanted to help out each other on latest developments and latest happenings. And then Hadoop Summit has started in 2009 in various cities all across North America, and then slowly it has moved to all other countries, you know. And Doug Cutting, the founder of Hadoop, joined the Cloudera in 2009. Okay, this is all about the history of Hadoop that you should need to know. Okay, next concept for today, Hadoop ecosystem. We have already seen this earlier, right? So let me move on. There are so many crazy animals that you can see in Hadoop framework, right? So particularly, there are no reasons for naming this, but all the reasons sound crazy to me. Okay, this elephant that you see here, which is the symbol for Hadoop, okay, is a toy elephant of Duck Cutting's son. Okay, so he just wanted to rename Nudge because it does not make sense anymore, since the concept was entirely changed. So he wanted to name it as a new component, and his son was playing with a toy elephant, and then you know, he adopted that name to his new framework. Okay, that's how this logo and this name has come for this framework Hadoop. Okay, so, and then Facebook has you know, given a tool called Hive, right? So Hive is a data warehousing kind of application. So it gives data warehousing capability to Hadoop. Okay, so Beehive. So since the data is organized in some way, they wanted to name it as some Beehive. You see, this is a bee with elephant head. Okay, so another thing, Hadoop database. HBase is a NoSQL database which is fast. Okay, so all other tools in Hadoop are batch oriented, but this HBase is, you know, it supports random reads and writes, and it is a NoSQL database. So they wanted to symbolize this speed with some animal, so they have taken horse, right? Similarly, pig. Pig is an omnivorous animal. It eats both vegetarian and non-vegetarian. So here it is. Pig is suitable for processing both structured data and unstructured data as well. So that's why they have chosen, you know, pig for this particular tool. Okay. Okay. Now let's move to the technical definition part of it. What is Hadoop? Okay. technical definition of Hadoop. What Hadoop is? Apache Hadoop software library is a framework that allows for distributed processing of large data sets across clusters of computers using simple programming models. Okay. So it is a framework, okay, for processing large data sets across cluster of computers. Okay. So the programming models that are used in Hadoop are simple. It is designed to scale up from single servers to thousands of machines. So today you might have data, around 100 GB of data, which is stored in two machines. Tomorrow you have another 50 GB of incoming data. So what you can do is you can add just one more machine, okay, to accommodate the new data. Day after tomorrow, if you have 200 GB of data, you can just add one more machine to your cluster. Okay, so Hadoop is designed to easily scale up from single servers to thousands of machines. Okay, so each machine will hold some part of the entire data set. Okay, no single machine can hold big data, right? That is why we have cluster of computers, and each machine will store large amount of data. Okay, so as we discussed in challenges of big data, when we have so many machines, so much hardware, it is prone to, your cluster is prone to failures, right? So how to overcome these hardware failures? In general, traditionally, what we'll do in traditional systems? Can someone answer this? Traditional systems, how will they overcome hardware failures?
Backup.
Sorry?
Backup.
Okay. Essentially, they use enterprise level hardware and software, right? Agree? So the software which is used by those normal traditional applications uses hardware and software from companies like HP and IBM, right? So those are high class enterprise level. That means the hardware itself is very costly. Okay, so it unnecessarily increases the cost. Okay, so say you have to save 10 terabyte of data on enterprise level hardware, that is like huge cost on your client. Okay, he can't afford to store 10 terabyte of data on an enterprise level hardware, and that is the reason why people do something called as data archival. Okay, they will just retain last few years data and they will ignore previous data. Is this a limitation or is this a requirement? Can someone tell me this? Data archival concept, is it a limitation or is it a requirement?
Limitation.
Yes, it seems to be a requirement initially, but this requirement has come out of this limitation. Okay, we can't afford to save all the data that we have. That is the only reason why people go for data archival. Okay. So if we use enterprise hardware and software, there will be no other option except to do this data archival. Okay. Now what about Hadoop? Hadoop, rather than rely on hardware to deliver high availability, the library itself is designed to detect and handle hardware failures at the application layer. So generally we will go for enterprise level hardware, but Hadoop uses, Hadoop cluster uses commodity hardware. That means readily available hardware or cheap hardware. Okay. Since we don't go for enterprise level hardware, we'll just use readily available commodity hardware. And that's the reason why Hadoop is more prone to failures. But how does Hadoop overcome this is, rather than rely on this hardware, it relies on the inbuilt library. Okay, its library is intelligent enough to detect and handle failures at application layer. Okay, We'll see how this detection mechanisms work and how Hadoop handles this hardware payloads later, after a little while. For now, just remember that the library handles it. Okay. So that's how it is delivering highly available service on top of a cluster of computers, each of which may be prone to failures. Okay. Now, what are the key distinctions of Hadoop? So what makes Hadoop so popular is it is highly accessible. Okay. So what is meant by accessibility? So any guy with relatively less startup cost, who wants to incur less startup cost, can start his own cluster, can set up his own cluster, Hadoop cluster. Okay, because Hadoop cluster is, you know, formed from a commodity hardware. So any guy can start building his own, have his own Hadoop cluster and start working on it, and it is robust. Okay, since Hadoop handles failures gracefully, we call that system as robust. Okay. So the framework itself is intelligent enough to detect failures and handle failures. That's the reason why Hadoop is a robust framework. And it is very simple. Okay. So both the programming model and the storage part of it are very simple. So, you know, you don't need to worry much about handling your data or handling or writing your programs. Okay, and the final point is it is scalable. Okay, scalability is also both from the perspective of storage and also processing. Okay, so if your cluster has to store 100 GB of data today, you can store it. Tomorrow your requirement is you have to store 200 GB. Still your Hadoop system can scale up. Okay, scale. And then you have written a program to work on some 100 GB of data. Tomorrow your data is 200 GB. The same code with minor configuration changes, you know, can be reused. Okay, that is the reason why both storage and code are also scalable. So these are the key distinction factors of Hadoop. Okay. So let's move to various Hadoop components. So if someone asks you, what is Hadoop? You can just answer them in a single sentence. That is distributed storage plus distributed computation. Okay. So Hadoop stores data in a distributed way. Okay. So it is distributed storage plus distributed computation. Say suppose you have 100 GB of file. How would it be stored? It will be split into say suppose two parts, right? So one part, my first let's keep ourselves to 100 MB of file. So if you have a 100 MB file, okay, so this will be split into 50 MB and 50 MB. Okay, so this will sit in one machine inside my cluster, and the second part of my data will sit in another machine of my cluster. Okay, so the storage is distributed. Now you have to analyze the data, analyze this 100 MB file, right? So if you say analyze this 100 MB file, what happens is, you know, what do you think should happen? Do you think this file should be integrated and then computation should happen, or do you think computation should also be distributed? Which is the better option? Guys, can you answer me? Which is the better option to analyze?
Can you repeat the question?
Say suppose you have a 100 MB file and if you want to run some program on it. Okay, you have a 100 MB file and you want to run a program on this file. Now your file is physically located stored as two different parts. Part one is in machine one and another part is in machine two. Okay. Now what will you do to analyze your file, run a code on your file? Will you integrate these two parts and then will you run the code, or will you do it separately? Which one do you think is better? Okay, Sam, thanks for your answer. Any other answer? Just which one do you think is better? Combine them together or process individually? Can I expect one more answer from you? Sagar, Sampath, Anjan. Yes, Sagar? Trying to say something?
No.
You can just guess. There are only two options. Which one do you think is better? Individual processing or processing together?
I think individual is better.
Okay, thanks for your answer, Sagar. Pawan, what do you think? Pawan, are you there? Anjan? Anjan, can you hear me?
Yeah, tell me.
Yeah, what do you think is better? Processing this 100 MB file as a whole or individually?
Individually.
Okay. Thanks, guys. So, Shyam, Sagar and Anjan. Yeah. So, you know, yesterday we have seen distributed processing, right? So, okay. Say suppose processing 100 MB file will take 10 minutes. Now, can you tell me how much time will it take to process 50 MB? If 100 MB takes 10 minutes to process, how much time would it take to process 50 MB of data? Yes? Yes, Sagar. Thanks. So, Sagar says 5 minutes. That's true. So what I'll do is I'll split my 100 MB file into 250 MB parts, each of which will finish in 5 minutes. So what is my total time now for processing 100 MB file? If I do the processing in parallel. Did you get the point?
No, I didn't get the point.
Okay. If you have to process 100 MB file, it takes 10 minutes. Okay. So, what about the time that would be taken for 50 MB file? How much time would it take? Half of it, right? Because the data is half, time would also be half. Agree?
Yes.
Okay. So, now what I'll do is, as my file is divided into two parts, 50 MB part and another 50 MB part, what I'll do is I'll run my code on this 50 MB and I'll also run my code on this 50 MB. So this will finish in 5 minutes. This will finish in 5 minutes. So what would be the total time? If I process this file as a whole, the total time would be 10 minutes. Agree?
Yes.
If I process this individually, the total time would be how much?
10 minutes.
Sorry, 10 or 5. Here we are doing parallel processing. Both of them were at different places and we have started simultaneously. So what is the total time taken now?
5.
5 minutes, right? So that's the whole idea. So that is the whole concept here, guys. So parallel processing, or distributed computation, or distributed processing. Okay, so Hadoop provides this distributed computation. Okay, So we can appreciate this concept more when we have a large amount of data. Say suppose you have 1000 MB of data, which takes 100 minutes. Okay. Now, if you split this data into several 50 MB blocks, 20, 50 MB blocks, each of which will take 5 minutes to process. Okay. The total time taken to process 1000 MB of data is 100 minutes if you process it as a whole. But if you divide it and if you process it, you know, the total time taken will be just how much? 5 minutes, isn't it?
But Pawan,
yes.
You are only talking about passing time, and what about recouping the results back?
Exactly. Okay. Come to that. So there should be some mechanism to aggregate the output of each individual component, right? Okay. That will be another task to it, and you know, MapReduce is exactly dealing about the same. Okay. The term MapReduce is nothing but map plus reduce. Map is what this individual processing, okay, executing your task on individual data chunks, and then reducing is aggregating all of this data, okay. Guys, please give me 2 minutes. I'll be back. 2 minutes. Hello, sorry guys. Okay, so we were discussing about, you know, distributed computation, right? So you will split your file into several parts and you will process each part of it individually. Okay, that is called map phase of map reduce. And you know, aggregating all the outputs from map phases is called reduce phase. Though it will take very less time. Okay, so instead of 100 minutes, now your total time to process a 100 MB file would be, you know, it will be around, say, 15 minutes. Okay, so that is the advantage you will get when you go for distributed computation. Okay, so Hadoop is all about distributed storage and then distributed computation. Okay, now this distributed storage is provided by a distributed file system called as HDFS. Okay. And then this distributed computation is achieved by a framework by a programming model called as MapReduce. Okay guys, that's what it says. And Hadoop runs on commodity hardware. Okay, Hadoop runs on commodity hardware. So the cluster of computers that we are talking about are cheap hardware, readily available hardware, not enterprise level hardware. That is another point to note. Okay, so let's see each of the storage components and processing components individually. Okay, let's talk about HDFS. So in HDFS, how the data is stored. Your data is split and distributed across nodes. Okay, if you have a 100 MB file, your 100 MB file will not be stored as is. It will be split into various parts and then it will be stored across nodes. Here node is nothing but a different machine. Okay, we'll call each machine as a node. Okay, a group of nodes form cluster. A group of nodes form a rack. Okay. Node is nothing but a machine or a server, and group of nodes form rack, and group of racks form your cluster. Okay. So in Hadoop, in HDFS, data is split and distributed across nodes. And then, how do you think Hadoop, in one of the previous questions, someone has told me, how do we achieve this, how do we handle failures? So, to handle failures, what would we do? Generally, we'll take a backup of the file, right? So, that is the purpose Hadoop adopts a concept called as replication. Okay, so each part of your data will be replicated. Okay, so say suppose if your 100 MB file has to be split into two parts of it, 50 MB part and another 50 MB part. Now how this data would be saved is, if 50 MB is saved in machine one, right? So that replica of 50 MB, replica of first 50 MB will also be saved in machine 3. Okay. And the replica of the second 50 MB will be saved in a different machine, in machine 5. Okay. So if you want to get back your 100 MB file, okay, so it will go and fetch this 50 MB first, and when it is trying to fetch 50 MB from machine 2, say suppose it is crashed, how can it recover? It will go to a replica of second 50 MB and it will fetch from the machine 5. Okay, so that's how Hadoop handles failures, hardware failures. Okay, it is handling hardware failures by a mechanism called as replication. Okay, is that clear guys?
So every machine, like every, will have one replica, right?
Yeah, there is a default replication factor in Hadoop. It is 3. The default replication factor in Hadoop is 3. So we have overall 3 copies.
How 3 copies? Like 2 copies, right? One machine, one the original and one replica of the original. So 2 copies.
Either one. We have 2 copies of original. Okay. You have 50 MB, first replica, second replica. Okay, total 3 replicas of one file, one part, and 3 replicas of the second part. Okay. The default replication factor is 3. So it is configurable again based on your requirement. If you don't specify anything, by default it will be 3. If you want to have this 2, you can just configure it to be 2. So it will be 2. If you configure it to be 2. Okay. If you want it to make it 4, you can still go ahead and make it 4. Okay. So it's configurable.
generally, what is the pattern that the companies follow? They keep it default or they do change?
Yeah, they keep it default. 3 is good enough. Okay. Because for every 1 GB of data, you have to, it will occupy 3 GB. If your replication factor is 3, that means if you have to save 1 GB, that itself occupies 3 GB. Now, if you go for replication factor of 4 or 5, it will still increase your storage, right?
Correct, correct. Right. Multiples by 3.
Yeah, that's why 3 is generally preferable. Okay. I heard some voice. Anyway, so you might ask me, so here unnecessarily we are increasing the storage cost, is it? Because for 1 GB file, if it occupies 3 GB of storage space, it will increase the cost, isn't it? But the answer is, storing 3 GB in commodity hardware is a cheaper affair when it compared to a storing 1 GB of data in enterprise level hardware. Okay. As simple as that. 3 GB, saving 3 GB in commodity hardware is cheaper. Okay. So that's how, you know, Hadoop is still cheaper. So now Namenode is the master. This Hadoop follows master-slave architecture. Okay. So there will be a master and there are multiple slaves in Hadoop configuration. Okay. So in storage, when it comes to storage, the master component is Namenode. We call Namenode as the master component. Okay. And slaves are data nodes. We'll have one master component by the name node, and we call data nodes as slaves. So what are the responsibilities of name node and data node? We'll come to that later. Okay. On a high level, you know, you have to split your file, right? So name node knows how to split your file, and name node knows where to send the splits to. Okay. Slaves are data nodes, right? These data nodes accept blocks to be stored. These will accept blocks. These blocks will be stored in data nodes. Who will tell where to store these data nodes? That is dictated by name node. Okay. So that's why we call it as master. Okay. Let's move on to processing part of it. Okay. So MapReduce. What it does? It splits a task across processors. Say suppose your task is to analyze 100 MB file. Okay, your task is to analyze 100 MB file. What this MapReduce does is, it will split your task across processors. So since this 100 MB file is split into several parts, say 2 parts, now MapReduce also, what it does is, it splits the task across the processors. Now processing this 100 MB file will also be split into 2 parts. Wherever it is stored, the code will be sent to this part and the code will also be sent to this part. So in general, what happens is, your data will be fetched to the place where this code will be executed, right? But in Hadoop, the code will move to the data. Okay, whatever code that you write, it will go to the place where this data block is sitting. And the same code will also go to the second data block. Okay. The code will run on first data block and also the code will run on the second data block. Okay. So this way, my first block will return one output. My second block also will return one output. Okay. So execution is near the data and then the results are merged. Okay. Because we are just processing a part of data, we have to merge it to get the final output. So MapReduce does it for us. So as a programmer, you don't need to worry about, you know, splitting your code and then sending it to various machines and then merging those results. Okay. Why I call framework MapReduce framework is Hadoop framework as a simple framework is, as a programmer, you don't need to worry about, you know, the various aspects of splitting the file, saving the file and then processing the split file. you know, sending the code towards it, merging the results and all. All of these are taken care by Hadoop framework internally. The only thing you need to do is just develop your code, assuming that you are just doing a sequential processing on 100 MB file. This code will be taken and it will be executed in parallel. That's the beauty of Hadoop. You will just think that you are doing some sequential programming, but it will be converted in parallel. You don't need to worry about the underlying nuances of it. Okay. So it is self-healing. Now there is a problem here. Now what if when you are executing this 50 MB block of data, what if this machine which is holding this 100 MB of data is crashed? What if it crashes? Okay. So can you guess the answer? Say suppose you are processing this 50 MB file in machine 1 and this 50 MB in machine 2. Say this machine 1 has crashed. What could be the scenario? How do you think framework will handle it? Anyone can guess? Can someone guess?
It has a replica, right?
Yes.
So it will fetch data from replica.
It will fetch data from replica. It will go to that replica and process it. Execution is near the data. So you're almost right, Sagar. Thanks for the answer. Right. So if this system crashes mid-process, okay, your framework will start processing on a different machine, on a block of data which is having the replica, on replica of the same block. Okay, this 50 MB block of data is replicated in machine 3 and machine 6 as well. So it will choose either of these and it will start the same process again in this machine. Okay, because the processing is near the code, the code processing is near the data. Okay, so the code will move to machine 3 and here it is executed. Okay, so who dictates all this? Job tracker is the master. So to initiate a process, okay, job tracker is responsible. When it comes to processing, the master is job tracker. We call that master as job tracker. Now, who accepts tasks? It is nothing but task tracker. So job tracker says, run this code on, okay, job tracker says, run my code on this replica. So in this machine, a task tracker will be there. This task tracker will accept the task and it will run your code. Okay. So when it comes to processing, job tracker is the master and then task tracker is the slave. There are multiple task trackers. Okay. So far, so good. Is everything clear so far, guys? Any doubts so far regarding Hadoop components? Is that clear? Shall I move on? Yes? No? Well, I take it as an S. And then let's try to see this, see these Hadoop components in a diagram which makes it easy for us to comprehend. Okay. So this is your cluster. Say this red color one is your master node and the blue ones are slave nodes. Okay, so we call these processes of job tracker process, name node process, task tracker, data nodes as daemon processes. Okay, you might have, those of you who know Java might have heard about this daemon process, right? It's a process which runs continuously in the background. Okay, this daemon process runs continuously in the background and it waits for tasks to be assigned to it. Whenever some task comes to it, it will readily accept it and it will do the processing. Okay, so all these are daemons: job tracker, name node, task tracker, data node. Okay, so we have one master node and then we have multiple slave nodes. Okay, so in our master node we have two daemon processes running. What are those two daemon processes? Name node and job tracker. Okay. So this is just a logical separation, the black color line, and this is just a logical representation of HDFS cluster daemons, and this is MapReduce cluster daemons. So above this line, above this black color line, the daemon processes that are running are related to storage, that is MapReduce. Under this black line, we have daemon processes like name node and data node, right? These are related to Hadoop cluster. Okay, so that's the reason behind this logical separation. It is not some physical separation. Anyway, so when you want to save a file, okay, you will request name node. Then name node will assign various data nodes to save your file. So then you will go and save your file in various data nodes. Okay. So whenever you want to save files, you will individually contact the data nodes. First you will contact name node. Once your name node is the location, you will contact data nodes. Okay. So name node is a master when it comes to storage. Data nodes are slaves when it comes to storage. Similarly, when it comes to processing, if you want to process certain file, okay, you will request job tracker, because this is the master when it comes to processing. Once you request the job tracker, it will initiate task trackers, okay, wherever your file is sitting. Say suppose your file is sitting in data node 1 and 2, okay, so job tracker will initiate task tracker on data node 1, another task tracker on data node 2. So this task tracker will process my first block of data. This task tracker will process my second block of data. Okay. These two blocks of data will be merged. The results from these two task trackers will be merged and processed by third task tracker. So job tracker will take care of this. Okay. So this is a high level view of, Hadoop architecture. Okay, Hadoop components and Hadoop architecture. Is that clear so far, guys? Any doubts so far? With this, I conclude today's session. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. Any technical related questions?
I didn't clearly understand the MapReduce and this Hadoop components. But we can continue tomorrow. You can give a quick revision tomorrow, like in 5 minutes, and I'll try to understand.
Okay, that will be good. So all of you, could you please ping me your contact details on the chat window, your mail ID and your phone numbers. Okay. Sagar, I haven't given you the detail level information about MapReduce, but I have given you, I have explained the Hadoop components in detail. So we'll anyhow go to MapReduce. We have a separate module for MapReduce. This is just a high level introduction. Okay. But Hadoop components I have covered entirely. So yeah, we'll recap it for you. If you have any doubt, you can ask me straight away.
Yeah, and can you send me the text file which you were explaining?
Sure. We'll send that. Please send.
Yeah,
all of you, please ping your contact details on the chat window. We'll get back to you. Okay. Sagar, what specific doubt you have regarding this Hadoop component? What's your doubt?
No, the logical separation you were trying to explain.
Yes.
So I quite didn't understand that part itself. Like, what is a cluster? What is HDFS cluster and that?
Okay. I'll just quickly recap that. Say this red color box is your master node. That is one server. Okay.
Okay.
These blue color ones are your data nodes or slave machines, slave nodes. Okay. So
this blue color is the data where all the datas are there.
Yes, this is data node, not just data. I'll come to that.
Okay.
This master node plus all the slave nodes together constitute a Hadoop cluster. So cluster, is that clear to now what cluster is?
Okay.
The second question, the logical separation. So let me come to that. In your master node, there are two daemon processes running. What are those two daemon processes? Can you see here?
Job tracker and name node.
Yes, job tracker and name node. Okay. So my master node is having one daemon processes that is related to MapReduce, one daemon process that is related to storage cluster. Okay. So I just want to segregate these two. That's the reason why I have drawn a black color line here. Nothing more. Okay. So it says whatever that you see above the black line is related to MapReduce. These are all related to storage components. These are storage processing components. Okay. Whatever under my black line represents the processing components, data node and name node. Okay, these daemons are related to storage. The ones
below processing MapReduce, right?
The ones below the black line are storage components. The ones above the black line are processing components, right? So MapReduce does the processing for you. Storage is achieved by HDFS. You know that, right?
Yeah.
Storage is in Hadoop distributed file system, which is nothing but HDFS. So
okay.
These daemons are related to HDFS. These daemons are related to MapReduce. Is that clear now?
Okay. Yeah. Clear. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Sagar. So, any other doubts? Any other technical doubts, guys?
No.
Sagar, I got.
Pawan.
Yes.
I have a question.
Yes.
So Hadoop. What kind of? I've been hearing from you saying is used for processing and all, huge data and all.
Yeah.
So is it only for only used for processing the data and getting results, or is it used in a commercial way? Where are these will be applied?
Okay. So once you process your data, you'll get some insights out of it. You'll get some, idea of how your process is working, right? So in Hadoop, you will first store your data that you want to process, and then you will write a program to process that data. Okay, the first part is you'll store it in HDFS and you will process it using one of the programming languages or using one of the tools. Okay, so say suppose you have some data like this. Okay, take an example of Amazon website, Amazon.in. Okay. Say it has all the user information from different geographies, okay? Mm-hmm. All the users and their items that they bought, okay? So suppose they want to compare two different geographies like US and China market, okay? Mm-hmm. How much sales were happened in US market yesterday and how much sales in US China market. So they will just have these two data sets inside their HDFS and then they will run a code on both the data sets. Okay. They can quickly compare. Right.
Okay.
So this processing, so assuming the size of this website, Amazon, it is so huge, right? So obviously there'll be so many transactions all across the world. So such huge data, if you want to save, obviously you have to go for some non-traditional system like Hadoop because it will be cheap, relatively cheap. And the second thing is it is fast. Whatever processing you want to do, you can do the same, you can come up with the answer for same question using some regular data warehouse applications also. But those are costly. And also when the data size increases, they cannot scale to the sizes. Okay.
So basically, you have to do something like this, what you're saying. I would have to transfer my traditional database data into Hadoop and then do the processing, right?
Yes. You have to transfer the existing data. The new data, you can directly keep on loading into HDFS rather than first loading into traditional systems.
Okay.
Okay. The advantage here is you can store directly from a text file. You can store structured data, you can store unstructured data, you can store log data. So as we see, big data is of supports all kinds of data, all varieties of data. So so that's how it is more powerful than any other traditional system.
So can I hook up my website to my Hadoop database and then
yeah
for, all the websites does or
some log files, right? Your website would generate some log files.
What I was wondering is, let's say Amazon, right? Amazon uses maybe Oracle, right, for doing processing, taking customer orders and everything.
Right.
Can they use Hadoop itself to do instead of the traditional database? That's my question.
Yes, they can. They are doing, in fact. In fact, all
okay,
big
companies.
So they are doing
itself.
Okay.
I have a following question with that topic. So let's say, like you said, like Amazon is a big company and they must be using obviously big data Hadoop, right?
Right.
So now, if they are using already, so by now they must have replaced all the traditional systems, or they still load the data in traditional systems and then they load into HDFS.
Right, right.
Like
so, yeah. Some processes, you know, HDFS is not a replacement for this is a highly debatable topic even today. From past few years, it's been in the same mode. Okay, our Hadoop system cannot entirely replace a traditional database system. Okay, it just acts as a complement to it. As of now, POCs are going on, right? Literally, you know, people are not completely resorting to eliminating databases, because you know they just want to see the possibilities. Without 100% confidence, you know, they cannot do that. Right now, I can say people are not 100% moving towards Hadoop. I mean, they're not entirely moving their database. Okay, suppose you have raw data. There is another use case in Hadoop, that is, if you have some raw data which you want to do some processing and then you want to store into your DBMS. So basically it's ETL, we call it ETL, right? Extract, transform and then load. So if we have to do that, we can use Hadoop. And then you can store your data again to your RDBMS. Of course, no one denies you, no one asks you not to store your data in HDFS itself. But people are still saving the data in RDBMS and also HDFS.
So in that case, do we require to understand the RDBMS in depth?
No. If an application is there, there are several components into it, right? You know, it will be a mixture of some data warehouse thing. It will have some ETL components in it. So the entire you as a developer, as a programmer, you won't be part of the entire process. Okay, you will be part of the Hadoop process of it. Either you will be part of the ETL processing of it, or either you will be part of the database processing of the application, right? So the bigger picture might be different. You will work in one part of it.
Okay, thank you.
One last question, number one. Does this complement the traditional data?
Exactly. Though some people feel that Hadoop can serve as a replacement, this is still in
right.
Early stages. Okay.
Okay.
People are not venturing it to replace entirely with database, mm-hmm. because database is much more, and this is much more.
Right.
So there is a clear overlap, but you know, it is not entirely the same.
And what about the commercial, point of view, like after getting trained, what are the chances of getting a good project, and what is that scope of that job?
There is a very huge shortage of talented pool in big data. If you see some stats, please search for that, you will easily find it. Okay. Clearly, there is a shortage of talent. Okay, so companies are looking for guys who have experience in this. So after this course, probably you will be able to, you know, claim as 1 year experienced guy, because I'll make sure that I'll give real time projects to you, and I'll make sure that I'll give all necessary concepts very clearly. Okay, so based on the POCs or projects that we're going to discuss, you can work on them and you can apply for jobs. obviously, you know, hopefully you'll get very good chance based on your course and experience.
Mohan, don't forget to send the text file, because that's the only thing I have, like, I'll recollect all the things.
Okay, we'll upload this video, no problem. We'll upload this video in the knowledge space, you can access it.
Okay, and can you also send the text file? It will be easy to revise everything in one text file.
I'll do that. Monica will send that to you. Thanks for sending your contact details. Sampath and Shyam, I don't see your contact details in the chat window. Please drop your contact details. We'll get back to you. Okay.
Thank you, Pawan.
Yeah, thank you so much for joining this session. Have a good day. Good night. Bye.
Thanks, sir.
Yeah, Sampath. I don't see your details in Sampath.
Yeah, typing.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Bye. Then,
How much? I mean, I think yeah. Wait, what is the fees? How much is the fees for the whole course?
Monica will get back to you. HR from MindSmap, she will get back to you.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Are we done for today?
Yes. I'm closing the session.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Anjan, are you there?
Hello. Pawan, tell me.
Yeah. So, you have any doubts, or have you given your contact details to Monica?
Yeah. And did everybody left you both on the line, or did others are there on the line?
Who is this? Who am I speaking to?
This is Anjan.
Anjan, right. I don't see you on the list. That's why I have this out.
No, yesterday I gave my details and I'm in touch with Monica.
Okay. I can see some other guy as well. Yeah, you can just a second. Let me stop this recording.